Good morning, viewers. Welcome back to our series of FB Live, which we get to you every Saturday, sharp at 11 o'clock.
Good morning, viewers.
So today's topic is how to keep depression away. And bringing us this topic is Dr. Ali Khwaja, our chairman and founder and our mentor. And he will talk about depression, a word which is randomly used. So what is depression? Let's listen to Dr. Ali Khwaja.
Very good morning to all of you. Yes, I don't know whether when we say depression, what thoughts come in your mind. Maybe you, some of you may feel, hey, what's so great about depression? Yeah, I've been in depression. The other day, I didn't get what I wanted to eat and I felt very depressed. And it's okay, we bounce back. Depression is part of life. What's so great about it? And things of that sort do happen, isn't it? Anyway. It is an essential part of life. Depression is as common as the common cold. What the common cold is in physical ailments, depression is in mental health. It is the most common among all the mental disorders. Now, even when I say depression is a mental disorder, it gives such a uneasy feeling. You start saying, hey, what do you mean mental disorder? Yeah, I was feeling depressed because this happened. So what are you talking about mental disorder? I'm not having. It's the same as when you have a common cold, when you have a little viral fever, 99 degrees and all that. It is a disorder. It is an ailment. It is something that you have to, do something about it. It may not be serious enough for you to go to the doctor or something. But yes, you do have to take some precautions. You have to take some care and things like that, isn't it? That is what I want you to, understand. Okay. First thing is, as it always happens, I hope by now you are also aware of that. Depression gets confused with sadness. Anybody who is sad, people presume that they are depressed, or anybody who is supposed to be depressed is supposed to be sad. That's not true. Sadness, yes, is definitely one of the symptoms, perhaps one of the primary symptoms of depression. But depression goes definitely far beyond that. Depression is where you not only feel sad, you also start losing hope or losing that interest in things. Whatever you wanted to do and you enjoyed doing and look forward to doing, if you find that, no, I'm no longer finding any joy or any interest. So I'm not able to get pleasure, joy from things which I used to get. Just to give you an example, there is this lady I'm counseling for years, homemaker, traditional Indian lady. For years, she had one ambition that her son should get married and he should have a child that will be her first grandchild, and she would focus around that grandchild. Okay. Now, the son did get married. It took some time for whatever the reason, they didn't have a child initially. Finally, the son had a child. Now, she should have been overjoyed. She should be spending all the time with that baby and, focusing around the baby. Suddenly people found that, no, she's lost interest. She doesn't seem to spend time with the baby. She doesn't seem to get the joy which she was looking forward to for years. Now, that was an indicator. People were wondering what's wrong with her. And you know what happens with depression? One of the most common things that happens with depression is people start putting all sorts of labels. For example, a person who is depressed and doesn't have the motivation to do his work and things of that sort. You know what they say? They say he's a lazy person. He's competent, he's capable, he's physically fit, and why isn't he working? They don't realize that the cause is depression. In the case of this lady that I'm talking about, people started saying, no, maybe, you know, I think she doesn't like the daughter-in-law, and because it's a daughter-in-law's child, something of that sort, that is why, you know, she's not taking interest. Maybe that's her way of taking it out on her daughter-in-law. She's not showing interest because of that or something. People start reading all meanings into it except the actual one, which is that she was, thankfully now she's much better, but at that point of time she was going through severe, you know, clinical depression. And here was this cute little granddaughter whom she had looked forward to for years, but she couldn't bring herself to spend time or to enjoy herself with the little baby. So this is what I'm trying to help you to understand, that depression is far beyond sadness. It is when you stop, you know, being able to enjoy what you want to do, what you used to enjoy. It is when you, you know, find that motivation is lost. I know that I have to do this, but still I cannot bring myself to do it. It is when you develop pessimism. Instead of hope, you start developing pessimism. I don't think anything will be all right. One of the common things, since, you know, I don't think any session is complete without using the word COVID nowadays. So, you know, you are talking about COVID and this depressed person will immediately tell you, I don't think this will go away. Or I think it will wipe out the whole human race. I think every one of us will die of COVID. You know, some such pessimistic thoughts which go beyond logic. Remember that also. If I am pessimistic logically, saying that, you know, certain things are happening and this and that, then it's understandable, but it's not that way. The pessimism goes beyond logic. So if you understand, starting with the symptoms, that if a person starts feeling, you know, sad, if the person cannot enjoy things which he or she used to enjoy, if that person's motivation level goes down and the person is unable to perform and do whatever he or she was supposed to do, and if the person becomes very pessimistic and, you know, starts losing hope and starts looking only for the negative things in life, these are very simple, you know, the symptoms which you know that something is not okay and this person is possibly going through depression. So remember that also, that it is not that all of these factors have to be there. Just to give you an example, there is a concept called a masked depression. I'm not talking about the COVID masks which all of us are wearing right now. You put on a mask on your own face. You feel like crying, you feel like having a sad expression, but you put on one bright smile, that is a mask. There are people, I'll come back to that little later, there are people who actually put on a mask because they don't want sympathy and pity from others, because they are feeling miserable deep down inside, but they don't want that sympathy, pity. They find that, you know, people will look down upon me and things of that sort. They put on a mask and they become more lively than what they were earlier. These are the type of things that I want you to, you know, understand. Okay. Now, I'll run you through two or three very basic concepts and understandings about depression. And as always, please feel free to make any comments, ask any questions. The more we can have a dialogue and the more I can respond to your actual concerns, the happier I will feel at the end of this session. So starting with the causes. Why does a person become depressed? We can broadly categorize them into two. One is what we call as reactive depression. That means I'm reacting to certain external circumstances. I have lost my job. My relationship is broken. I've had a major health setback. I have lost money in something or the other. Now, my mind is reacting to that. So that's why we call it reactive depression. I've gone into depression from the time I lost my mother and I was feeling miserable about it and I really couldn't bounce back with the grieving process. So I am under depression, and that depression is reactive to the loss that I faced because of the death. The other counterpart of that is what we refer to as endogenous depression. E-N-D-O-G-E-N-O-U-S. Endogenous. Endogenous depression comes from within. We do not have a 100% clear idea as to what, how it happens, because it is a malfunctioning of the mind. It is happening inside the mind. And as you may be aware, the mind and the brain is the last frontier of medical science. We know 90%, 99% of various organs in our body, but we hardly still know 10 or 20% about the functioning of the brain and the mind. So something happens within the mind. It is not a reaction to something else. It is something within me. The easiest perhaps definition that I can give you is that there is a malfunctioning. It is like a short circuit in the brain. You know, you've got all these wires inside the brain connecting this to that, that to this. And if you've seen electrical wires, complicated electrical wires running from one end to the other and intermingling and things of that sort. So if you have that wire system inside the brain, and somewhere along the line, there is a short circuit. Some wire connects to some other wire which it should not be connecting to. And that is why I start going into depression. So we will categorize into these two. Now, what happens when a person, you know, becomes depressed? As I told you, he starts feeling negative. He starts feeling sad. There are occasions where the person becomes numb, you know. He just doesn't know what is happening. He feels that the world outside is like a virtual world. I'm seeing it, but I'm not connecting to it. It's like I'm sitting and watching a TV show or a movie or something of that sort. So he starts getting, you know, disconnected. He also starts, you know, showing many of them have in symptoms like, for example, insomnia. That is quite common. That is lack of sleep. And it aggravates. The less I sleep, the more I'm worried, the more I brood, the more my health takes a toll on me, and the more depressed I get. So you see how a vicious cycle starts building up if I don't take care of my depression. These are the type of things that, you know, keep happening. It could be loss of weight, it could be fatigue, it could be a sense of worthlessness and those type of things. It could be a sense of letting go. I don't care what happens to this. I don't mind if I lose my job. So what's so great about it? What's so great about relationships or anything of that sort? What I want you to understand is that if out of all these that I've been talking about, if there are at least 50% of these, then you know that we need to do something about it. There may be some of these symptoms which I mentioned, which are just not there. Doesn't matter. Some symptoms, if it is only one or two out of these, it doesn't matter. You can become a little aware, but you need not, you know, think about it seriously. But as I said, if at least half of these symptoms seem to be there at whatever level, one may be 90%, one may be only 50%. But as long as many of these symptoms are there, the first thing that we need to do is to acknowledge and accept that, yes, I do have depression. There are people who do not want to admit that they are depressed. There are people who think that depression is only to those who are mentally weak, who cannot handle their own life, and those type of people. I am a great guy, I am strong enough, I can deal with anything, all those things. I don't have to bother, I will not feel depressed or anything of that sort. Denial is not going to help you. Any of these mental disorders are exactly the same as physical disorders. If you get fever, you don't say, only the weak people get fever. I'm a strong guy and I can deal with it. I don't need doctors. I don't need treatment. It's okay. I don't bother about fever. We don't say that, no. The same thing applies over here. If these symptoms are coming up and if there seems to be depression, what do I do? First level is help yourself. If you still have that type of willpower, that inner strength, which says, yes, I identify that I have depression. It is because it's a consequence of this that has happened. Maybe one major setback has happened, or maybe a series of small setbacks have happened, which by themselves, each one of them would not have much significance, but all put together have pulled me down. So yes, I think I have gone into depression. Acknowledgement of depression is the first essential step. If you are in denial, then obviously you cannot get help. You cannot help yourself and nobody else can help you. So there's nothing wrong with it. It's not only mentally weak people. It is nothing of that sort. If I am depressed, I am depressed, and it can happen to anybody. Believe me, the strongest of people, the best of people. You have all heard of Winston Churchill. He was the Prime Minister of UK, and he was the one who fought the Second World War against Hitler as the Prime Minister, and he won the war. Now, Churchill was not only known for his bold ideas, his courage, his leadership, he was also known to be a very aggressive and a very cruel man. They say that the Bengal famine, which wiped out millions of people, was caused because of the negligence of Prime Minister Churchill, because he just didn't care about those people. He said that, let them die, I don't care. So while he has all these traits, somewhere deep down, he also went into depression. Amazingly, he was a person who admitted it. He gave a very nice, very unique description of his depression. He said, my depression is like a gloomy, very ugly looking and a very unfriendly black dog, which keeps following me wherever I go. So whatever I do, wherever I'm trying to go, there is this black, horrible dog following me. And therefore, I cannot look forward to going wherever I'm going, or I cannot look forward to doing whatever I want. This dog is sort of controlling my life. So that was just to give you an example that once a person admits that, yes, there is depression, then comes the question, what do I do? And as I mentioned, you start off first with helping yourself. Find out all the ways and means by which you can prevent going deeper into depression, or even if you're very deep in depression, how to pull yourself out of it. Two things here. One is to remember that the mind and body are connected with each other. The same way as I told you that when a person gets depressed, he doesn't feel like doing the work which he was normally doing. He doesn't feel like going to office. If he's a student, he doesn't feel like doing his studies or giving the exams or going to class. If she's a homemaker, she doesn't want to do. She used to enjoy cooking for the family and taking care of the house. Now she just doesn't feel like doing it. So physically, there's a somatization that takes place. Soma is the body, psych is the mind. So depression in many cases becomes psychosomatic. The mind controls the body. Now, that is one of the reasons why you can use the body to control the mind. So when you are having this mental depression, if you can do physical things also, it is a great benefit. If you push yourself and say, I'm going to keep myself busy and I'm going to do meaningful work. If you can say that I will maintain good health, I will do exercise, I'll go for a walk, I'll do gymming, whatever I like to do, I want to keep myself fit. I don't feel like eating, I've lost my appetite, but I'll make sure that I eat good, nutritious food so that my energy levels are high and I'm feeling fit and fine. So that is the first part I want you to remember. Do not differentiate between the mind and the body. And because the mind affects the body, use the body back to influence the mind. The second thing is, divide the depression treatment into two parts. One is, what am I going to do now? And the other is, what am I going to do on a long-term basis? What I am going to do now is, on a daily basis, if I have a child in the house and I play with the child, I feel lighter. If I listen to some soothing music, I'm a music lover, I feel nice. I've got a green thumb. I do a little bit of gardening and I feel nice. So start off with doing the activities that appeal to you. If you are a religious or spiritual person, reinforce yourself by whatever, reading some, you know, spiritual books or chanting some mantras or being part of some satsang, whatever appeals to you. If you are the social type of person, push yourself and get involved. Join some group or some club or something where you are surrounded with people. So that is the dealing that we do at a day-to-day level to ensure that you don't keep going deeper into depression. And you keep being fit in the day-to-day activities. But those who have gone through severe depression will say, yes, Ali, I know all that. I did it. Or I'm doing it right now. During the day, I'm very occupied. I've got myself all sorts of activities to do. I do a lot of meaningful activities other than my own work. I go and help out somewhere. I do some social work. I help out some children or I do whatever I can. And I feel very nice. The whole day goes off beautifully. At the end of the day, when I come back to sleep, and that is when it hits me. Now that has to be dealt with from the second part that I told you. Go into the cause. Unless you remove the cause, you cannot continue to indefinitely distract yourself. So now you sit down and question yourself. What is it that triggered this depression? Was it because of a relationship? Was it because of economical factors? Was it because of health? Was it because of relationships or whatever it may be? Once I identify that, I need to work on it. And this applies universally. The first level is within yourself. For whatever reason, you can't do it by yourself. See if you have a best friend, a family member, a loved one whose help you can take and say, come on, please help me. I'm going to make this attempt. I'm not being able to do it by myself. Will you help me and we'll go through this together? If that is not possible, go to a counselor. There's no stigma. There is nothing negative about going to a counselor. Please understand that and please spread this word. If you can go to a counselor, get some help and bounce back easily, you stop that suffering. Otherwise, you continue to suffer for a long time. Now comes the second part of it. As I told you, some depression is endogenous. It is because my brain is malfunctioning. No amount of self-help, no amount of help and support from my loved ones, and no amount of counseling also helps. So if it has happened because of something like that, there is no cause, there is no trigger, there is no background to your depression. Or if there is a background which is physiological, then you need to go to a professional who will probably prescribe medication for you and who will see to it that this is dealt with from the clinical or the medical aspect. I'll give you one or two examples. People who go through menopause, it is an endogenous factor. It is happening from within. It's a biological factor, but it could lead you into depression. So if you are going through menopause and suddenly you've started becoming negative, losing interest, etc., ask yourself, is this taking me to depression? Postpartum depression. Innumerable times I have seen a woman who was really looking forward to becoming a mother and finally she gives birth. It's the happiest time of her life. But within few days, people see that she is no longer interested in the baby. She has gone into depression. This is what we refer to as postpartum depression. There's another very common one which hardly anybody gives any attention to because it happens so frequently. And that is what we call as the PMS, premenstrual syndrome. There's a huge contingent of women from teenagers to people who are just coming up to their menopause. Just before their periods, they go into depression. And They may have a fight with their spouse, they may get irritable, they may stop doing things. And within 2-3 days, they bounce back and they say sorry to everybody and they move on. And the cycle keeps repeating itself every year. When I tell this to people, hardly anybody gives any importance to it. I've had occasions where a counselee comes to me and says, you know, my husband is a wonderful person and we share a very good relationship. But every now and then, you know, we get into a fight. And he becomes so unreasonable and this and that. And for 2-3 days, it goes on and this and that. Anyway, finally, I reconcile and I say, okay, done. But then after some time, again, it happens. So I stop her and I ask her, did you check the dates on which it happens? She said, what dates, sir? Is it some astrology? I said, no, it's not astrology. It is biology. Does it happen to you just before your periods? And many times they raise their eyebrows and say, oh, is it? I didn't realize that. There are times when I've said, please tell your spouse that when I'm coming to this stage of my monthly cycle, please tolerate if I'm going to be irritable or if I'm going to be short-tempered or if I'm going to withdraw into a shell or whatever it is. Okay. But one word of caution also. I've had occasion where I've had wives coming back and saying, my husband is very angry with you. Because when I went and told him that, you know, I'm going to be depressed and I'm going to be angry and I'm going to be irritable for 3-4 days, she says, what sort of counselor have you got? You know, he's given you the license to fight with me. Okay, that's only in a lighthearted way. But these are the things that can be done. Endogenous depression responds very well to psychiatric medication. Reactive depression responds very well to counseling. These are the things which I want you to keep in mind. Become aware, tackle at the symptom level on the one side, and similarly tackle at the cause level at the other side. And you know best what suits you. Take the help of, as I said, a family member, a counselor, in the extreme case, a psychiatrist. But finally, it comes back to you. It can lead on to what you do. Sunita has asked, can you please brief about seasonal depression? Yes, that also happens. Thankfully, we live in a Mediterranean country, so we don't see too many of those cases. In the cold countries, there is a thing called SAD, S-A-D, seasonal affective disorder. When the winters come in and everything becomes gray and dark and days become shorter and shorter, people tend to go into depression. This is another thing which is not tackled very well. People say, you're living in Great Britain. What do you expect? Yeah, the winter is going to be. No, there are certain people who get affected by SAD and they do need therapy. They do need treatment. So these are some of the things, you know, which we need to keep working on that. Once you become aware that this has to be tackled, it becomes so much more easier. There are a few people who tend to, you know, who can fight depression well. They are people who have realistic goals, long-term goals. They are people who, they don't say the glass is half empty, they say the glass is half full, you know, the optimists and those type of people. People who have some sort of belief in their future or their karma or whatever you want. People who maintain good physical habits, eating on time, sleeping on time, maintaining good sleep and those sort of things. People who are aware of their mood changes and they caution their loved ones and they move away and they say, okay, let me recoup, get back my mood and then get back and not get into arguments and things of that sort. People who don't live in the past all the time. People who don't bring back the past and say, last month this happened, 10 years back this happened and that sort of thing. And people who do not take responsibility for others unnecessarily. This is the category of people who fight it out well. But whether you belong to that category or not, how to deal with the depression, a few very good important tips I shall give you, as they say in the TV serials, after the break. It's not actually a break. I am requesting my colleague, Ms. Purnima, our director, to just give you a quick brief and an overview on what we do and how we can deal with not only depression, but various other things. and then we'll start off with the therapy part of it.
Good morning, viewers. As Ali was just mentioning that nothing is complete without our mentioning the lockdown. So when the lockdown happened, we decided that, you know, we have to reach out to people. So let us try and make our humble attempt and an earnest effort to unlock, you know, the emotional barriers or the limits that people have regarding various issues. It could be, you know, understanding the emotional needs of children, or it could be understanding the teenagers. So living happily with teenagers and various other topics of human interest, which has been checking the career changes at any stage of life. So we are trying to cover as many different ages and stages through our talks and trying to reach out to you. And if you feel that there could be any particular topic which can be of, you know, which you would like us to address, I will ask my colleague to put up our email ID so that you can write to us telling that, you know, these are possibly the topics which may be of help. If we can accommodate that, we would surely want to do that for you. I would also, you know, just want to remind you that since these topics are of human interest pan world, it may be a good idea that you can feel free to share this information with anyone, whoever can come into the time zone of India and want to be awake, you know, to listen to these interesting topics. You can, you know, possibly feel free to share it with them. In fact, I thought I'll take this opportunity to tell you of some of the very interesting topics which will be coming up every Saturday, you know, from now onwards. And a few of them are, if that can really be of interest to you. One is falling in love again. What does it mean? Falling in love again? Yeah, it is that. And what does it mean? Can I do that? Should I do that? Would I do that? Could I do that? All these would, should, could, Dr. Ali will be bringing to you, making you understand that how falling in love again can also lead to the second topic, which is that happiness is a journey. So we will be taking you through this. So this is these are the topics which can be, you know, useful to anyone, any age, any stage, because all these things are what which will help us to create our inner freedom, which is the third topic which has got lined up. And if it interests you, if you think that you or anyone who's known to you can benefit significantly from this, please feel free to share it with them. We'll be more than happy to reach out to as many people. And with regard to this, if you think that there is any kind of, you know, emotional turmoil or any kind of an issue which anyone would want to address, by now you would all be knowing that counseling of any type at the academy is free. It can be face to face. And by the way, our office has been fully functional with our fabulous team of, you know, our staff and our members who are here anytime to pick up calls, to meet up with people. Aptitude counseling, if you cannot do it at Banjara, you can do it online. So our team is ready to even help you out with online. And for that, we have to be in office and, you know, coordinate a lot of things. They have been doing that. You can write to us, you know, your counseling needs through email. You can call us up and we'll be only very happy to be of help, if at all. And we are also ready at this point of time to be taking in your questions with regard to depression, with regard to sadness, with regarding to whether depression needs counseling, whether sadness needs medicines. So over to Dr. Ali, who is just getting ready to answer your questions.
Yes, back again. Yeah, back again. Before I start answering your questions, just take a minute to quickly tell you what needs to be done to overcome depression, or if you are getting close to depression. That is why I mentioned the topic as keeping depression away from you. So whether you are depressed or not, but if you are heading towards that, if circumstances have been bad, which could be possibly, you know, taking you towards it, or whether you are already into depression, the first and the most important thing that I feel strongly about is talk it over. Talk to somebody, be selective. Don't start talking to anybody and everybody. They'll start laughing at you. They'll give you free advice. They'll tell you so many things which are not really, you know, good for you. But select one or two good people and talk it over. If that is not helping, talk it over to a counselor or somebody like that. As Punima was just telling you, we are there. There are so many other wonderful counselors all over the place. You can identify, you can link up with somebody and be consistent till you feel that you've come out of it. That's another important thing I wanted to tell you. Some people do go for counseling, but then they give up very fast. The moment they feel a little better, they say, now I'm okay, I don't need to go to a counselor. See that you complete the process. The same way as when you go to a doctor and he gives you medicine, you complete the whole round of the medicine, the whatever number of days or whatever it is, the same thing has to be done. The other I've already mentioned to you, physical activity. Body plays an important part in controlling the mind. Analyze what we call as the worst case scenario. What's going to happen in the worst case? Okay, I've lost my job. What else will happen? Okay, this relationship has gone bad. What will happen? Just thinking about that worst case scenario and saying that, okay, if it has to happen, it will happen, but I will move over the thing. That also, you know, helps. Having long-term goals, some dreams, some fantasies, one fine day I'm going to be doing this. That helps a lot. Many people benefit from relaxation, pranayama, yoga, meditation. If you are that type, please go ahead and use that. Have some support groups, like-minded people with whom you can sit and talk about something. If this pandemic is affecting you because of all the media and all that, make a group of 2-3 positive and happy people where you say that, let's sit and talk about, once this pandemic is over, how we are going to enjoy life, and we are going to all go for a vacation, or we are all going to start this new activity and thing. That will give you this thing. Finishing off some tasks which are pending, which have been worrying you and all that. Don't procrastinate. Once you get over them, you'll feel much lighter and you'll be able to tackle whatever is going on in your mind. And as I've told you, I'll conclude with that if nothing works, don't hesitate to seek medical or psychiatric intervention. There are excellent psychiatrists, and today antidepressants are 100% safe. They are non-addictive. They do not have any major side effects, provided you take it under the supervision and prescription of a qualified person. So keep that in mind. Get back to us also if you feel like anything. So let me start going back to your questions. If a person comes to a counselor and after talking, the counselor realizes the person has symptoms of depression, but the counselor is in denial, how to convince or handle it? Talk about the symptoms. If the person is in denial with regard to the word depression, it doesn't matter. But you are not being able to go to work, or you find that you are not even, you know, spending time or playing with your children, or you find that you're not being able to enjoy the things which you used to enjoy earlier. Let us work on that. So work on a symptomatic basis. Rajendra has asked, is depression only a mental illness or is it connected to behavioral concerns? They're all interconnected, Rajendra. We can't strictly differentiate between the two. But my concern is not to talk so much about labels and these and that, but to talk about, you know, how to deal with the situation. That is what is important. Tina says, does depression lead to hatred and anger on someone? Yes, it could. It doesn't necessarily happen, but it could happen, because when I'm feeling pulled down, I'm feeling depressed, I want to take it out. I'm frustrated. I want to know who is responsible. Why is the world treating me so badly? So incidentally, if I've had a bad relationship or if I'm angry with somebody for a small thing, it blows out of proportion. That's what I told you about PMS. There are women who love their husband, who have a wonderful relationship with their husband, but they get into a very bad argument or fight during the days of the PMS, and that can in the long run affect their long-term relationship. Keep that also in mind. Then what else do we...
Ali, Naveena is saying that if a person comes to a counselor and after talking to the counselor realizes that the person has symptoms of depression, but the counselee is in denial, how do you convince or handle?
No. That's what I just answered, Seema. That you don't have to talk about depression. Forget the word depression with such a counselee. You say, okay, you're not in depression. You're not in depression. But I am concerned about the fact that your relationship with your child or your spouse or your parent is not good. I'm concerned about the fact that you are not performing well and you are getting firing from your boss. Shall we work on that? Work on the symptoms part of the thing, right?
Right, Ali. Shaila is saying, my father is 79, suddenly going blind. Where is he going? Is he going into depression as he's so independent till now? How can I handle him?
Yes, Shaila, this is quite possible. A lot of elderly people, when they start losing control over the basics, you know, somebody is arthritic and he cannot, walk. Somebody starts losing their hearing. Somebody starts losing their sight. And particularly if the person has been very active, very energetic, very positive, contributing to society, taking up responsibilities. Now, when the person realizes, I can't even see, I can't read, I can't do anything, it can definitely lead. So now this is a typical case of a reactive depression. Start looking at the symptoms that I told you. If you find that he's losing interest in something, if he's becoming pessimistic, if he's getting into bad relationships, you must nip it in the bud. Start helping him to look positive. And in this particular case, whenever there is a disability issue, I always tell them, work on the abilities and not the disabilities. So if you find that he is losing his eyesight and he will not be able to read tomorrow, encourage him to get on to music. Encourage him to get on to some other activities which do not require eyesight, that sort of thing. So at an individual level, we can discuss these cases whenever you feel like. Please either come over, phone us or write to us. We will deal with it at a individual basis. Raji says, my friend says that you have to relieve and think about your past traumas to get over it instead of moving forward. As I told you, you keep moving forward, you work on it symptomatically, you work on your day-to-day positivity. At the same time, to fully resolve it, you do have to get back to your past traumas. So your friend is right. If there have been traumas which are emotionally still hurting me, which have not been emotionally resolved, they will keep continuing to pull me down. So it's better to resolve it either by myself or with my loved ones or with a counselor. Sonia says it's compulsory to have done studies in psychology to help someone or to counsel someone. Not at all, Sonia. You will find that some of our best counselors, people who have been trained by us at a practical level, had absolutely nothing to do with psychology. They are engineers, they are teachers, they are social workers, they are homemakers, they are bankers. They come from various streams. It is more of the human thing which is involved. Counseling is a very humane thing. That's what we say. Right now, for example, the registrations for the new batch of our diploma in counseling skills are going on. We do get every now and then we are getting somebody who says, see, I come from this background. I am a software engineer. Can I do counseling? I am a legal professional. Can I do counseling? I've never worked in my life. I've been a homemaker all my life. Can I do counseling? I'm a retired person. Am I too old to do counseling? The answer to all these people is yes, you can. It takes that human approach, which is what we ascertain, and we start training them on the skills. Sonia also said, I want to help people who are in depression or want to do suicide. How can I help them? Suicide is an extreme form. A lot of depressed people, not all, but a lot of depressed people do tend to have suicidal thoughts when they lose hope about the future and all that. How to deal with suicidal people is a very serious matter. I don't want to just, give you 1 or 2 minutes tips and all that. But we do work on this on a regular basis. If you get in touch, I will tell you. I've also got one of my books, which is on how to prevent suicide. If you can just pick that and keep it as a ready reckoner. Whenever you come across somebody who is feeling suicidal or who's already attempted suicide, you can use a lot of tips from that. Uma says, my observation is men are more sensitive and feel lonely than women. In general, yes, Uma, you are absolutely right. And the reason for that is simple. That is the first thing that I told about, what you need to do for relieving depression. Talk it over. Women generally, I'm not saying all of them, But women generally find it easier to talk over things like depression or emotions and all that. That is why the men suffer more than that.
Right, Ali. Anupama is saying that old age people, when they lose their spouse, how do they handle their depression?
Yes, yes, yes. That's another factor. The same way as we mentioned about the gentleman who is losing his eyesight. Whether you're losing your eyesight, whether you have lost your life partner, whether you have lost your position where you used to be an important person in some career, and now you find that nobody cares for you. All these may lead to suicide. Depression. And we need to deal with it in the same basic principle that I've been talking about. That's only the cause. And then we have to resolve that cause also. Okay, now you've lost your life partner. Who else is there in your life? Do you like to spend time with your son or daughter or even with your grandchild? Do you want to become part of a group of senior citizens where you meet like-minded people and have some good company? Do you feel like traveling and going out somewhere and doing something? That way you have to keep working on the this thing.
Right, Ali. Raji is saying, my friend says you have to relieve and think about your past traumas to get over it instead of just moving forward. Is it so?
I've just answered that.
Okay.
Mars says, good morning, Ali. Kumar here. Happy to listen to your talks. I'm getting the positive feeling of being in DCS class long back. My question is, how can we differentiate in the first or second session about what sort of depression is the client going through, endogenous or... Don't worry, Kumar, you don't have to put labels. I'm a very strong believer that we deal with the human being and his well-being rather than putting on the scene. What I'm talking about endogenous or clinical depression is when you find that you are hitting a wall. First thing you do is let the person come to you, let the person talk it over, encourage the person to say whatever he or she wants to say, feel lighter. Then if you realize that, no, this is not helping, this person still continues to be in depression, this person is going into clinical depression or something of that sort. Over a period of time, slowly prepare the person to say, I've been seeing that the last few weeks or months you have been suffering continuously. I don't want you to continue to suffer. Would you like to take the help of a consultation with a doctor or a psychiatrist or something? The symptoms will be relieved. I'm still there for you. We will continue with the counseling. If you get in touch your known senior citizen people through digital way like SMS, WhatsApp, how much is that helpful and how frequently? Why not? It depends entirely how frequently they are open to it. You will get a feeling. Ask them, am I bothering you? Am I intruding in you by contacting you too often? As long as they say, no, I'm happy that you spoke to me, fine. Sheetal says, a person not ready to take counseling, then how can we help him? No, we can't, Sheetal. We have to be aware of the fact that we have this limitation. You can take the horse to the water, but you can't make it drink, right? So the same way, you just keep nudging the person once in a while, gently reminding. You will find if that person is in touch with you, one fine day he'll say, I'm so angry at this, or I'm so depressed at that. When is this lockdown going to be lifted? Why is this happening? Why is that happening? That is when you bring in and say, yes, I don't want you to suffer. I want you to please improve your this thing. I feel bad for you when you're such a nice person and you're going through this. That's how you slowly bring it about. In many cases, you succeed. In many cases, you don't succeed. You have to leave it at that. Tina says, how to convince somebody to see a counselor if they don't think they have a problem, but trust of the family is exactly what I was telling Sonia also. That just keep gently telling the person, I feel bad that you are going through this suffering. I am feeling very concerned about you. I know that you are such a good person. You can lead a much better, more enriched life. But I see that your quality of life is suffering because of whatever is happening to you. So is there some way that we can work on this? How would you like to do it? Give the choice. If the person says, no, I'm a spiritual person, I'll pray to God and I'll feel nice, so be it. Let him try it out. But he comes back a few days later and if he's still feeling depressed, then you say, would you like to? You continue praying. You continue with whatever you believe in. But would you also like to talk to a counselor or something? That's how you have to go about it. Indra says, I have a person who's 62 years old. Any kind of motivation will not change him. He's aware of what he is doing is wrong. But after listening to what he is told, he get back into the cocoon and same kind of negativity is seen. Keep trying, Indra. Keep making gentle efforts. Keep making different type of things. You have a good book. You just show him and say, I just read this book. Uncle, how is this? Would you like to read it? Leave it there. Don't even ask him to. Whether he read or not. After a few days, come back. If he has not read it, take it away. Try something else. Say that I like this activity. Have you seen that movie. I really enjoyed seeing such and such movie, you know. Can I share that with you? Keep looking at different types of activities. Keep asking him questions. How was your day? And the moment he starts talking about himself, counseling is already taking place. Tina says, what's your suggestion to prevent people getting into depression as family members? It's a little more difficult, Tina, because you know you are concerned, you're directly involved with it. But yes, why not? Just give support and be there. Be a sponge to your family member. Whatever that other person is, you know, bringing out, take it. Even if the person is irritable, angry, at that moment you take it. And then slowly take him forward and try and see if you can take him to an outsider, maybe an extended family or a friend or a neighbor or some, you know, elderly person, somebody whom he respects or somebody whom he is close to, and failing which, a counselor or something. You have to keep trying that. How can one deal with past trauma? There are various ways and means. You have to go through, go back into that trauma, relive it, discuss it threadbare with somebody, identify what were the emotions at that time and how many of those emotions continue to be real now. So at that time I was feeling angry. How angry? Very angry. Nine out of 10 on a scale of 10. Yes. How are you feeling now? It's past. It's gone. 1 year, 10 years have gone past. Today, how are you feeling? If the person says it's 1 out of 10, good, you made progress. Encourage the person and say, try and eliminate that 10% also. But if the person says that even after so many years, it's still 5 out of 10, then you have to start working on resolving the past, going back into the past, finding out what were the emotions, what can be done about it, what cannot be done about it, what you have to accept because you cannot change the past. How would you like to, you know, build a positive mental attitude towards it? How would you like to take precautions so that something like this doesn't happen to you in future? How would you like to build better and stronger relationships with good people around you and things of that sort? Sangeeta says, sometimes it gets very stressful to always be happy and cheerful to maintain a positive ambience. How to draw a line between getting stressed out and feeling depressed? Firstly, Sangeeta, don't stress yourself to be happy, please. That is what I mentioned about this masked depression. Don't put on a mask and all the time try to be smiling because people around you or your loved ones may feel that. Be natural. Once in a while, do that. And then when you feel better, you say that, hey, the whole morning I was feeling upset here. You must have seen me, how grouchy I was. But that's not true. That was just a little bad phase, something of that sort. Now I'm feeling much better. Come, let's enjoy ourselves. Let's do this and that. So the more you keep, you know, putting on that mask or whatever it is, it definitely gets stressful. You don't have to maintain a positive ambience all the time. There are times when you can tell your near and dear that I'm not going to be positive. I'm going to be real mean and grouchy, and you guys better accept me the way I am. Tomorrow you are grouchy, I will accept you. But today is my day and I want to feel grouchy and I want to shout at you people. Build that type of relationship. Does depression relapse? Ranjita has asked. Yes, definitely it can relapse. In fact, people who have gone through very bad depression and have come out of it are a little more prone for depression than people who have always maintained a positive attitude and things of that sort. So if you have gone through severe depression, not the ordinary little ones, few days here and there, but if you have gone through major depressive episode and this and that, and you finally come out of it, be aware that chances of your relapsing may be there. Take the necessary precautions. Rima says, we have got to be as honest as possible with oneself. Exactly. It starts with that. As I told you, you have to be self-aware. You have to say, this is what is the reality and this is what I need to do and work on those things. Kumar says, nowadays, we all in fast-paced world. Usually, people need to come out of depression as early as possible, but which may not take place in counseling process. What is your message for these depressed minds? Life is very long. Slowly start making the people understand that whatever your age is, you're probably going to be living another 30 years, 60 years, whatever is your normal life span. Let us not do firefighting. I can give you relief. It is like a paracetamol. You have fever, you take a crocin, you know that in the next half an hour, the fever comes down. But that's not the solution to the fever. No, you have to find out what caused the fever and get the infection out of your body. The same thing happens over here. Rashmi says that really works. Family will give space for our venting out. Yes, it does. Bharti says it's difficult to stay positive when people around you are very negative and pulling you down. Yes, Bharti, I agree. That's a good point. I'm glad you raised it. When you are surrounded by people who are negative, look for at least a few people who are positive. They need not be in your immediate circle. You may have a friend living in another country, but who's a very lively, cheerful, and positive person and who cares for you. Connect back to him or her and say, hey man, I'm surrounded by these people. When I talk to you, I feel very nice. Can I call you up every now and then? And can we have a chat? Can you go on a video call where you see that bright smiling face of the other person? And slowly you start counterbalancing the negativity that you are facing from your near and dear. Raji says, if one sibling is dominating without her knowledge, the other one feels resentful of her. How to change that, even though it's long gone and the sibling has changed? Yes, we carry all this from our childhood, you know. Many a time, we may say, oh, that happened when we were children. Now we are grown up, we are mature and all that. But some of these traumas still remain with you. So if such a thing has happened, first thing you do is resolve it within yourself before you contact your sibling. Don't be in a hurry to go to your sibling and talk it over and all that. It may even make matters worse. The sibling may protest and say, hey, I never did that. Why are you accusing me or something of that sort? So go ahead and first resolve it in your mind the way I have been giving you tips. And once you're more comfortable, then you go to the sibling and say, no malice meant, no accusations or something. But this is what happened when we were children. Can we now build a better relationship and can we, you know, move on into a better adult life? Ishal says, I was a student of Banjara Academy, DCS 2012. It helps us to take care of ourselves. You understand what is psychology. It really helps to understand people. Yes, Ishal, I can afford to be a little immodest and take your praise and say, you are one of innumerable people who keep feeling that way. And I feel very happy and very proud that you know each one of you has been transforming your lives and making it so positive. Simi is asking, any specific points in depression in teenagers? Yes, we can. The methodology differs a little bit. If you can get in touch with us, I'll give you a few tips on that individually. I don't want to say it in half a minute. As I told you, some of these things we really need to look into a little more seriously. Anjali says, sometimes it gets difficult to take care of the moods and fancies of all the family members and still maintain our balance. Our feelings take a backseat. That's exactly what I was telling you, that when you realize that there are moods and fancies of your family members which are pulling you down, counterbalance it. If you can change your family members and bring them to a positive attitude, nothing like that. But if you cannot do that, just counterbalance it by having positive people in your life and ensure that you spend at least some time, if it can't be done in person, at least over phone or correspondence or whatever the thing is. Nandini is asking, I have a couple for counseling. Can I refer to Banjara? Definitely, Nandini. Anytime you can, just give them our phone numbers, ask them to call up. And then if they want to come over, they are most welcome. We are functioning Monday to Saturday, full days, and they can come over. Or if they are hesitant because of this lockdown business, they can talk to us on the phone or they can send us emails. We are open to anything. We maintain confidentiality. They can even send an email without disclosing their identity, and we are still open to it. So all this goes on, and as we are coming to the end of the program, let me wind up by telling you that depression is very, very rampant. It is natural. It can happen to anybody the same way as you can catch a cold or a throat infection or anything of that sort. Nothing to worry about, provided like any other physical treatment or any other physical ailment, you take cognizance of it at an early stage and work it out. We are very lucky that today medical science has advanced so much, psychological science has advanced so much that we can nip it in the bud. We can keep depression away. Not only for ourselves, we can help so many other people. Like how Irshad said, there are so many of our thousands of our counselors who are out there in society doing their wonderful work at an individual level, as groups and this and that. You also can become part of that, where you enrich your own life, you create a better world for yourself, and you create a better world for the few people around you whom you care for. That's all that the world needs today. So go ahead, keep depression far away from you, keep working on positivity, nothing is permanent. No COVID will take over and ruin your life or anything of that sort. All these will be in the past, and we will move on to a better world tomorrow. Best of luck and enjoy yourself. Happy weekend.
Thank you once again for joining us this Saturday. And next week is another very interesting topic on falling in love again. So see you all. In the meantime, I would also like to tell you that we have revamped our website. And please go to our website. You can see a lot of articles written by many of the students and people associated with Banjara. And there is Ali's Corner and Arb's Musing. Please go and read that and give us your feedback. So see you all next Saturday, 11 o'clock, on another interesting topic. And thank you, Ali, for another wonderful session.